class, we discussed about VBD, valence bond theory, and CFT, that is crystal field theory. So, what was the necessity of the CFT? Because there were many limitations of VBD, that is valence bond theory. One of the limitation of VBD was it fails to describe or it fails to give the coloration of the compounds, coordination compounds. But here CFT explains the coloration of the compounds. So here in the crystal field theory, let us know how this explains the coloration of the compounds. So as we know how the color can be seen or how the color can be observed in the compound, so as you all know, the visible light, as the visible light falls on the particular compound, so some of the radiations which matches the wavelength of this compound, it absorbs the colors and it emits the complementary colors. So hence the compound is, the coordination compounds are the colored compounds. Most of them here are the d block elements, so which shows dd transition, vacancy orbitals, so those shows the coloration of the compounds. So here in the crystal field theory we have example of titanium. Can you name this compound? Yes, definitely, hexa aqua titanium 2 ion or 2 complex, we can say. So it is having the violet color. Why it is having violet color? Because it absorbs blue or green color, so resulting the violet coloration of this particular compound. So how it can be explained by crystal field theory? What all we learned in the crystal field theory here? So you know it is having coordination number 6. It should possess which geometry? Octahedral geometry. Maybe D2 sp3 hybridization or sp3d2 hybridization. But still, it should possess octahedral geometry. In the octahedral geometry, crystal field splitting, how it takes place? The orbitals are, degeneracy is lifted and these will be discussed about why. So here it is not in plus 2, it is in plus 3 oxidation state. So hence you will be having only one electron in the d subshell, one unpaired electron in titanium 3 plus complex. Okay, it is not 2 plus, it is 3 plus. So hence here we will be having one unpaired electron in p2g orbital. Okay, in p2g orbital, if it is excited, so it will excite to, that is dd transition takes place. You learned this dd transition. Sorry, e-word in theory. In the vacant d orbitals, dd transition takes place. This is called as dd transition. Okay, one of this electron is jumping to the excited state, because here we have, this is the ground state, this is the excited state. So this dxy electron is jumping to the, or I can say p2g electron is jumping to the pg electron. So initially in the ground state, how we can say that p2g1 and Eg0. Initial ground state, Ne2, there were one electron in p2g and no electrons in Eg. But in the excited state, this electron is jumping. transition takes place and the coloration of compound can be seen. So this is violet in color because it absorbs blue or green color. So the complementary color violet is emitted or enmoshed. Okay, so this is how we can say that the crystal field theory explains the coloration of the compounds. Even the ligand which are attached here, they are very important. They play an important role in the formation of the color lines. Because if you will see that copper sulfate is white in color, that is colorless. If it is colorless, then what about this? Remember, this is blue in color because here we have copper. It forms the complex. So here this pentaaqua copper 2 sulfate is blue in color. So as you can see here, the difference that copper sulfate is colorless, whereas here this particular compound or this complex is blue in color because it is affected with the ligand. Okay, so here ligand plays most important role in the formation of complexes. Even if you will go through the complex, that is nickel, it is in +2 oxidation state. So here if you will see the addition of ligand to this particular complex again leads to the change in the color. Here it is green in color. Okay, when it is subjected to EN, what do you mean by EN? You all know that EN is nothing but the ethylene diamine. When ethylene diamine is added, two of the H2O molecules are taken outside because nickel will be in +2 oxidation state because it should obey the 6 coordination number. En is a bitentate ligand. It will give you 2 lone pair of electron to the central metal atom. Hence here you will have nickel H2O4En+. So please remember, this is green in color. As soon as you are adding one more ligand here, it gives you blue coloration. So this again, if you will add En, that will give you again replacement of H2O molecule to H2O molecule. It will give you nickel H2O. 4 becomes 2. So again En twice, 2+. Remember, this is purple in color. So if to this purple color you are adding one more EN, which is having again 2 lone pair of electron, it will lead to the formation of tris ethylene diamine nickel 2 complex, which is violet in color. Clear? So with this, what you understood? What is the summary or what is the conclusion of this? See, the coordination compound exhibit most of the colors or variation in the color compounds because it is due to the VD transition which is taking place in the coordination compounds. So here with these examples, you can easily say that the color of the compound is mainly dependent on the ligand to which the central metal atom is attached, to which ligand. Okay, so the variation colors can be seen here. So this is the coloration of compound which is explained by the crystal field theory. So limitation of crystal field theory, if you will go through the limitation of crystal field theory, so as you all know, it only able to explain the anion ligand should exert the greatest splitting, because you know here the anion ligands are treated as point charges. Being the point charges, they should repel and they should exert the greater splitting. But if you will go through the spectrochemical series, you will find almost all the halogens in the left corner. Sorry, in the right corner, being the weak filled ligands. Why we call it as weak filled ligand? Because there is no much splitting up of the d orbitals. So hence, it doesn't explain the anion ligand should exert the greater splitting. But it will not explain the why halogens are having, or halogens are known as weak filled ligands. Even it will not explain the covalent character of the coordinate compounds. So it will not explain the covalent character which is involved in the coordination compound, because it should exhibit only coordination bond, but it exhibits covalent character. The crystal field theory is not explains about the covalent character of particular compounds. And this is again explained by ligand field theory. That is not for your syllabus. So till this you learn. So this is all about the coordination compounds. Okay, in the till CFP you learned. Next you have metal carbonyls. So what do you mean by metal carbonyls? So you know the carbonyl compound. You heard this name in the organic chemistry. So here metal carbonyls. Metal carbonyl is nothing but you know CO bonding, correct? So it is attached to the central metal atom. These are the carbonyl compounds, or I can say. So this is the metal carbonyl. So we will discuss about the bonding. Before that, let us know what is metal carbonyl. So these are the carbonyl compounds which are attached to the central metal atom to form the metal carbonyls. So these are the homoleptic compounds. You know what is homoleptic? Containing single type of ligands are nothing but the homoleptic compounds. So the carbonyl compounds are the homoleptic compounds which are attached to the metal atoms. For example, here I have cobalt carbonyl. Okay, so here we will discuss about the compounds, their structure, and their which type of structure that exhibits along with the geometry. Okay, here I'll give you the table. You will see here the tetracarbonyl nickel. Please remember the oxidation state of carbonyl compounds will be zero because it is the neutral ligand. Okay, so here tetracarbonyl nickel, NiCO4. Please write not like this, it will be cobalt. Both should be a capital letter. Carbonyl, tetracarbonyl nickel, pentacarbonyl iron. So nickel possessing the tetrahedral geometry, whereas the pentacarbonyl iron is possessing trigonal pyramidal geometry. Here you will have the CO bonding. Okay, if you come to these two, hexacarbonyl chromium and the decacarbonyl dimanganese. So here you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. There are 10 carbonyl groups with 2 MN. So that is why it is called as decacarbonyl dimanganese, which is possessing 2 square pyramidal units. This is the square pyramidal unit. There are 2 square pyramidal units of decacarbonyl dimanganese. If you come to the chromium, here it possesses the octahedral geometry. As you can see, there are 6 carbonyl groups. So how the metal bonding is there here? See, this is called synergic effect, because metal and carbonyl group exhibits sigma and pi bonding. Sigma is when the lone pair of electron is donated to the metal atom, okay, by carbon to metal. And how the pi bonding occurs? This pi bonding, how it occurs? The metal is from D, that is transition element. So this will donate the electron, or it will give the electron to the pi star anti bonding orbital. So hence, even sigma bond and pi bond is present in this metal carbonyl group. That is why it is known as synergic effect. And the stability of these elements we will discuss in the CET class. Okay, so this is along with the application of coordination compounds. Where all the application of this coordination compounds we can see, we will discuss in the CET class, along with the stability of metal carbonyls or coordination compounds. So this completes your coordination compound chapter. Hope you understood this concept. If you are not understood, then you can ask me personally, or else you can call me. Thank you.